first getting into boxing was my dad took me down to a gym. My ankle was just that general, just keep fitting that, get into it. But what interesting at all at the time, I'm only 11, so obviously my spares off some other places. But actually my uncle got me properly into boxing about 5 years ago now. And that's where it started off. Sad, isn't it, really? Is that many good fighters? Probably Diego Chico Corrales. I like his style, dead sort of ranger, similar to myself. Probably Barry McGuigan. Yeah, I like his style, aggressive, come forward, action packed. So yeah, Barry McGuigan. Wow, right, here we go. Is that many? Probably, I'm torn between probably Gatty and Ward and Jamie Moore and Macklin. Two top fighters, but best British fighters got to be. Macklin and Jamie Moore. I don't know, probably a British title fight, something like that, isn't it? I can be a counterpuncher and I can box, I can fight, so basically that is full package really, I can box and I can fight, so say boxer puncher. Ruthless. Probably as an amateur, people call Michael Stupar. I boxed him as a pro, my pro debut. I had a tough fight with him for the Northwest title, the belt. I had a very tough fight with him, but it all changed into a pro. Stopped him as a pro, so you see the difference. A massive part of it is my daughter, my little girl, so she's a massive part, but I think every boxer boils down to his money. Everyone wants that money and that fame, so it's a tough thing to relax, really. Have a good social life, try to see my mates and friends and family, eat plenty of food and drink plenty of beer. Pray quite a lot. I do a lot of praying really, you know, into fights and out of fights, but I do pray quite a lot. Birth my daughter. I always wrap my right hand first, get this wrap my right hand, I always put my right glove on first. But to see how far I'm getting really. Hopefully win a British title outright. From a British title probably onwards and upwards, not too sure, but hopefully get to the top. I do like diving, you know, I watch a bit of diving, swimming, MMA. I do like watching, but key sports, just boxing. Manchester City News, that's it. Proper Man, that's it. Again, I like comedy films, so I knew what's just coming out in a minute. That Ted, that's funny. Alright, off that. Hip hop, R&B, and a little bit of dance music, but I'm a big, massive fan of reggae. So I do like reggae music, so that's the one. Chinese, love Chinese food. Lager. Catch a lime in it, though. Dog. Gotta be a dog. You only live once, that's about it. It's probably my phone. Phone's like one of the main things, really. Let's go for Brad Pitt. You know what I mean? Everyone likes him, they're laughing at him. I mean, he's in some good films and that, so we'll go for Brad Pitt. I got forced into boxing to be fair. I was messing about school, pure trouble. Got through out of school, so my uncle said get into boxing, try it out. And more or less, it sounds silly, it's like a bit of a punishment because I didn't really want to do it. But over a space of a few weeks, I started enjoying it. And then that's when the hunger started. And I thought, yeah, I'm alright at this. Getting loads of little comments saying I'm half decent and I've got like a little bit about me, so I kept some from there and that's where I am today. My proper box started when I was 15 and I went to a man called Sean Cruz, South African guy, and he taught me trade really.
Tell us about your amateur career. How many fights did you have as an amateur?
Amateur career, not a lot really. Only had 32 fights, 24 wins. So I didn't have a massive amateur career, and that was all crammed in the space of 3 years. So a very, very small amateur career. So not a lot of experience, but I boxed some decent, reasonable kids. Boxed like Ryan Mulcahy, Lee Hamran, Luke Campbell, who went to the Olympics, won a gold. So yeah, I boxed some reasonable good kids.
And some of the fights you lost, you were saying to me, you know, you've typical sort of amateur, amateurs say, you know, bad decisions and that. So.
Yeah, bad. I've had some very, very bad decisions put against me. But it's one of them things that amateurs, if you had the style, me personally, didn't have the style, but as an amateur, I was in a pro style, so my ideal goal was to go to the pros, it's just that, get the experience through the amateurs, and that was it, really.
And you turned pro at 19, so last year, was it?
Last year, so I turned pro very young. A lot of people say to be turned pro at age 21, 22, you know, a bit bigger, fill out, but it wasn't for me. Pros for me, you know.
You just had enough of the amateurs at that point?
Yeah, that was it, done. I couldn't be mad with it anymore. So many bad decisions put against me. It almost made me ill. The amount of times I wanted to throw the gloves away, you know, I didn't want to put them back on. And that was it. I'd rather just mess around with mates, you know, I'd rather just go and get a job. But it's that little bit inside you where you really want to do it, so just stop fighting, really, and just where I am now.
A big portion of your career was spent with Joe Pennant at Northside as well, wasn't it?
Yeah, good fights come through that. Big part of it, yeah. About 20 of my fights were there with Joe, and then I moved on to Bridgewater, Salford, and yeah, I think obviously my remaining 12 at Bridgewater. So, yeah, two gyms.
I was talking earlier about your experience going over to South Africa and spending some time there in the gym, sparring and training. How did that come about and how long was you there for?
I was there for 8 weeks, so it was a long period of time. It was actually when the World Cup was on. Don't get me wrong, I was there for the World Cup. Even though we went to watch some of the games, it was all about specifically training. Like I said before, I went over there with a man called Sean Cruels, who consulted me trade. I lived with him for like 3 to 4 years, every day, twice a day, and he taught me everything I know. And it was actually his pro gym from where he grew up, where it was, so that's where we went there. So experience wise, it was a massive experience, it opened my eyes up to real, because actually I was at 18, I was ready to go pro, thinking I was ready, but after being out there for 8 weeks, fighting with countless world champions, hopefully I've done half decent, but I did get an eye in, and opened my eyes, I thought, no, pro, it's not ready for me yet, so I had another 12 months over here, and then decided to turn pro.
Who was your sparring with in that gym?
Jeffrey Montebuzo, he's one of the kids. He's a former IBF world champion. Just lost his belt now to Nenito Dene. You know, I can't think, there's that many of them, but he's unreal. Another lad was Maruta Olingo. He's the IBF flyweight world champion now. Again, tremendous fighter. Really dangerous kids, and I can't think of that. There's that many kids that are over there with a sparring.
Real tough gym, yeah.
Yeah, really tough gym. I think at the time when I was over there, you had 23 or 24 professional fighters in the gym, and I think current champions at the time was something like 20 of them. Right. I have all African champions, South African champions, all world champions, so it's a very high caliber gym. Very dangerous gym, sir.
Dangerous. That was just before you turned pro, wasn't it?
And yeah.
You said it made you realise that you probably wasn't quite ready, having seen the standard of the pros in that gym. You know?
Yeah, it wasn't so much of the standard. If I'm not wrong, I most probably had the ability. It's just that my body wasn't big enough. I was getting bullied off. Even kids who were smaller than me, which was like little bantamweights. And he was bullying me around, pushing me around. He was manipulating me. Obviously, big men, a lot stronger. I was only a young boy in there. But again, training-wise, opened my eyes up massively. Great experience, best thing I've ever done in my life.
Away we go. Gas first. Delpho.
Right,
that. Good lad, bro.
I do believe I can make Super Bantam, but I'm not too sure if I'll be strong at the weight, so I stay at featherweight. Ensley Bingham recommends I stay at featherweight, so grow and get bigger in the weight and I'll be right.
You're comfortable with that weight?
Yeah, I made the weight very easily. Yeah. Really, really easy.
And struggle. Three fights up to now? You?
Yeah, three fights, three wins, yeah. Two knockouts.
Two stoppages, yeah, two knockouts. So it's all gone according to plan, and you know, you're over here training at the famous Champs Camp, Phil Martin Centre with Ensley Bingham and Maurice Course. You know, you're in good hands here, aren't you, Ryan?
Yeah, brilliant hands. I can't go to better people. Ensley's got all the experience in the world, obviously. British champion. I think he's WBO Intercontinental Champion and went on to box for two world titles. So, for experience, can't beat him against one of the best experience ever. So, he can put me in the right direction. And plus, he's not a busy gym. No disrespect to the likes of Joe Gallagher's gym and stuff like that. It's a very, very busy gym. Yes. No one's sure if you get the attention what you need. Where it is me, Jimmy Keller, Steve Foster. It's four pros against two men. It's easy to get the best time. Yeah. Quality time with everyone. So it's great. You know what I mean? You can work on stuff you need to do. So fault is no fault. It's brilliant. Top trainer.
He's a good guy, Ensley, and I know he rates you highly, and you know, he thinks that you've got a good chance of going far in the game, so you work well with together, don't you?
Yeah, it's very compatible. We have a good relationship between me and Ensley. One of them, we have a top laugh, but when training comes, the graph starts, and we've got a good connection with each other, you know, like between boxing. Both are very similar, you know, like injury-wise. Like, Ensley had a lot of injuries through his pro career, and like I'm seeing starting with him now, little niggles and training, but again, with Ensley having him, he's telling me how we've gotten with him, and he's helping me now through my career.
Yeah, so most of the fact, well, your three fights you've been in, you've been injured, haven't you? You had bad back and
this,
that, and
the other.
You just, just part and parcel of it, really, isn't it? And hopefully, try and obviously keep him as well as you can.
Yeah, I think it's just injuries, isn't it? Like you said before, it's just the wear and tear of the game. Ensley knows what it's like. I know what it's like. Well, I know now. You know, maybe the injuries, what's getting. Everyone thinks the fights go according to plan. And if it goes dead nice, but as I've noticed, I mean, the short career professional doesn't, it are very rocky roads, so just got to keep holding on and keep it up for the best, really.
You know, you had a crystal ball looking in the future, or you could even predict your own future. You know, what would that be? How do you see the path working out?
Well, everyone would love to be a world champion, don't at the end, but just one step at a time. Get this kid out of the way on next Saturday and then see where we go from there. So I'd love to be a British champion, win the belt outright, not like a lot of these professionals who win it and go on. I'd like to win the British title outright and then go up from there. But just see where we go. There's nowhere near the finished product yet. Still only 20, so see where I am when I'm 22, 23, 24, you know, physically developed and I'm ready to go.
But, you know, being a pro boxer and living this life now that you are, you know, you feel you made the right decision and it's onward and upwards from there.
Yeah, definitely. Regardless of decisions, yeah, with coming to this gym, best gym, I personally think, you know, to get one to one. yeah, I think it's one of the best series. Hopefully, onwards and upwards, and see how we get to the end.
Are you following in the footsteps of some great fighters that have come through this gym, without doubt, and obviously Ensley was one of them. But you know, there's a rake of fighters, so it's, you know, carrying on in them traditions of the gym. It's important, isn't it? And you've got a real history to keep going there.
Yeah, definitely. Some fantastic, you know, top fighters come out of it. Ensley Bingo being one of them, training Carl Thompson. Everyone knows about Carl Thompson, one of the best fighters out there, one of the best British fighters anyway at cruiserweight. Then you've got Maurice Hard Core. It's just great fighters in general, and the stuff that we're doing now is stuff that they were doing 20, 30 years ago when they was amateurs. So, like, we run around the Marines this morning, we've done 8 sprints, just same stuff that they do as a pro, what they did when they was in their peak, we're doing now. So, it's just part and parcel, really, just doing everything we're doing, it's all paying off.